Joining us now for the science of Inteng and the other natural disasters that beset the country, disaster scientist Dr. Mahar Lagmay. Hi, Dr. Mahar Lagmay. Thank you so much for joining us. Hi, sir.
Hello. All right. Good morning.
Good morning. Long time no see, Professor. All right.
Oh, we met recently.
I know. That's why when this Inteng happened, I just said we have to get you on air. I want to start with, Professor, it doesn't take much to disrupt life in the Philippines anymore, does it? I mean, some showers here and there, enough to suspend work and school and leave thousands homeless. Is this climate change in the works?
Well, a lot of scientists are saying that the last typhoon, Karina, was a climate change event. And there were other lines of evidence that show that there's climate change that's happening. There's sea level rise, the ice is melting in the polar caps, and a lot of other things. There's a lot of ocean acidification, the corals are bleaching. And there's a lot of evidence apart from the temperatures rising, which is bringing to us a lot of rains, a lot of bigger storms, and it's changing our lives. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, here in Metro Manila, we had Undoy, and then we had a lot of habagat events that made the Marikina River water level rise up to a certain level, which is, you know, unacceptable. We had Habagat 2012, Habagat 2013, Habagat 2014, Habagat 2018, Ulysses, and then we had Karina. That event, Undoy, was a one every 180-year event, and the Ulysses was one every 100-year event. The water levels were phenomenal. They're very high, and it's disturbing, disrupting our everyday lives. We had Inteng. It was not that much in terms of the rise in Marikina water level. But what I'm saying is that the frequency of these large floods is getting worse, is getting more frequent. Mm-hmm. That means that instead of experiencing it once every 100 years, we're experiencing it once every 10 to 15 years. So it's causing a lot of damage, and sometimes it costs a lot of loss of lives as well.
Mm-hmm. So what can we do? What can we do? How do we conduct due diligence?
Okay, for climate change, that's the question, right?
Mm-hmm. And for all of these floods that we, you know, whenever we do urban planning, when we buy a property, when we search for the lot where we build our house, when we live in our homes, what should we do? We should be preparing before these disasters strike, assuming that these disasters will happen more severely and more frequently.
Okay, there's a lot of things that we can do. Let me start from the general things. When we talk about climate change, We often hear climate change mitigation and climate change adaptation. So I'd like to clarify those two things, mitigation and climate change adaptation. When we talk about climate change mitigation, that means that we reduce the emissions of greenhouse gases, primarily CO2, that makes our Earth warmer. That means that if we reduce the CO2 emissions and greenhouse gases, we are actually mitigating the effects of global warming and climate change. And when all is lost, because it's really beyond our control, most of the countries that release greenhouse gases and CO2, burn fossil fuels, these are the developed countries like China, like countries in Europe, America, India as well. And the Philippines releases only just a small percentage, less than one, maybe 0.3, 0.4% of the global inventory of CO2 gases released by countries. The impacts of climate change are felt by us. So that means that because we have, we're in the typhoon belt, rather, the impacts of climate change are worst in our country. We have bigger floods, we have more landslides, we have bigger storm surges, and it actually impacts our economy. It impacts our daily lives. So we need to prepare for worsening conditions. These include sea level rise, worse floods. And to do that, we need to plan our communities well. We need to adapt to climate change impacts, those adverse impacts that affect us. So how do we do that? We have to plan our communities with scenarios of floods and all sorts of hazards that are bigger than the historical record. And we have to plan them not just for evacuation centers. We have to plan our communities across all sectors. The sectors of agriculture, energy, education, tourism, coastal concerns, biodiversity, the environment. If we plan well, we might be able to survive the onslaught of the adverse impacts of climate change.
And Professor, there is NOAA. We can always count and turn to NOAA to see the hazards, to know the hazards in our neighborhood, right? We just met last week, and I was struck when you said, you know, the maps that many of us, even our LGUs, are using are not updated. They're very simple maps. They don't use probabilistic maps, correct?
Well, I wouldn't say that they're not updated. They may be updated, but what I'm saying is that the maps that most of the communities in the country, all 1,634 cities and municipalities, are using hazard maps that are only up to the historical record. We need to create scenarios of hazards that are bigger than the historical record because of climate change. There are worsening conditions, worse floods, more landslides that we need to reflect in the hazard maps so that the community can use them to plan accordingly. So those kinds of maps are important because we don't want them to not anticipate the bigger hazards than what we have experienced. And if we mainstream that kind of information into the plans of the community, like comprehensive land use plans, disaster risk reduction management plans, we will be able to anticipate those future hazards that are bigger than what we know.
Mm-hmm. Can you give us, are there certain LGUs that stand out for you, Professor, best in class perhaps, who are able to use the maps, probabilistic maps, multiple scenario maps, to maybe locate some of their critical infrastructure like evacuation centers? Are there certain cities that stand out for you?
Oh, yes. We've actually helped around probably 40 cities and municipalities. Mm-hmm. I can identify some of them. Most of the mayors who seeked our help became three-term mayors. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of mayors there, administrators there that actually seek our help. And we try to mainstream the science into their plans so that when their plans are risk-informed and science-based, it translates to risk-informed and science-based projects, programs, and activities. Okay. These cities and municipalities include Science City of Muñoz, we have Naga City Cebu, we have Quezon City. We did their drainage master plan. Calaocan City is trying to seek our help. We also have a resilience institute that was created in Tarlac Province. We helped already do the comprehensive development plans of Taisan Batangas, Padre Garcia Batangas. And this is a very good example, Balanga Bataan. The mayor there and the people, the staff, their administration there is so into planning against climate change. They want probabilistic hazard maps, multi-scenario hazard maps that reflect climate change adverse impacts embedded into their master plan, embedded into their comprehensive development plans.
Mm-hmm. Professor, this sort of scenario that we're in today, I mean, just rain showers, habagat, enough to flood city centers. Is this reversible or this is it? And things can only get worse, or we can just keep status quo?
Well, first of all, I'd like to emphasize that floods have been happening ever since, okay? Even before climate change, the way we define it. So floods have been happening. What we need to do is to do good urban planning. If there's a lot of space, if the metropolis is not too overcrowded, we can plan the community to avoid where the hazards are. Mm-hmm. So for example, if you have development in a particular place, it's moved away from the path of a flood, then if the flood comes, they are out of harm's way and there's no disaster to talk about. So there's a lot of things that planning can do in advance. We cannot rely on ad hoc solutions when the problem cannot be solved anymore because it's too late. We have to plan the community well so that when they are planned well, it will be able to resist adversity, be able to bounce back at the soonest possible time, and there will be business continuity, and those plans actually translate to resilient communities, smart and resilient communities.
All right. Hopefully we can mainstream this mindset. Professor, pleasure speak with you, sir. Thank you so much for the science and the perspective. We hope to speak to you soon, maybe when there are more developments in the space. Thank you, sir. See you soon. Take care.
Thank you very much. Hope to meet you again in one of those conferences where you are act as MC. Okay.
All right. Thank you, sir.
All right.